Hello guys, this is Charles Clinton on the Coronary Angiography and Intravascular Imaging Chapter number 20 for Braunwald's Heart Disease, latest edition by now, edition 11. So, this is my disclaimer. These summaries are being done without any editing and just on the go, studying for an exam. So if they work for you, that's great. I like sharing. Please correct me for any mistakes or give feedback. So figure 20.15, we can see we're talking about coronary anomalies. Upper left, we're seeing a right circumflex. Okay, this is the circumflex artery arising from the right coronary sinus. And that's on the left. On the right, we're seeing an LAD arising from the left coronary sinus. Just the LAD. So this means that the circumflex is coming from another place. And in 2016, anomalous origin of the right coronary artery from the left is coronary sinus. The left main coronary artery has a separate ostium in the left coronary sinus and can be seen in the upper right corner. Okay, figure 2017 shows us different possible courses of the anomalous left coronary artery. So originating from the right coronary sinus. The anomalous pulmonary origin of any coronary artery is a very rare occurrence, and this is called APOCA. The most, one of the most common of these is the ALCAPA. ALCAPA is associated to a syndrome called the Bland White Garland Syndrome. And ALCAPA stands for anomalous origin of the left coronary from the pulmonary artery. This is highly high mortality. Almost 90% of these patients die within the first year of life. So the treatment for them is early CABG. Okay, congenital absence of a coronary artery. This is the most common coronary. The most common coronary absence is of the left main. Of course, if you don't have a left main, you need to have the branches that go after it. So this just means that there's no left main and that the left anterior descending and left circumflex originate from the coronary sinus without having a left main before them. It is considered, in general, congenital absence is considered a benign finding, and it's mostly found in circumflex or right coronary artery, and these have been shown to pose a benign prognosis. Now about hypoplasia. Hypoplasia is, by definition, a vessel wall diameter less or equal to 1.5 millimeters without compensatory branches. If there's hypoplasia of just one coronary, this might be a benign prognosis. It's not associated in general with sudden cardiac death. But if there's hypoplasia of more or equal to two of them, it is associated with sudden cardiac death. Anomalous termination. It is defined as the abnormal direct communication between one or more coronary arteries with another major vessel or a chamber, such as the vena cava, left or right ventricle, pulmonary vein, or artery. Now, in the figure 20.19, we can see coronary artery fistula. Coronary artery fistulas are more common of the right coronary artery and left anterior descending. Coronary angiography is the gold standard to detect them, and they are mostly found in an incidental fashion during CT, coronary angiography. Now, what are the pitfalls of coronary angio? Inadequate vessel, well, one is instrument, that instrument malfunction and can lead to low image quality and erroneous image interpretation. Inadequate vessel opacification, because of enhanced blood flow or competitive flow from a bypass graft. Myocardial bridge or coronary spasm can result in a minus defect in the coronary artery that can be misinterpreted as atherosclerotic disease, leading to unnecessary treatment. Here we can see some pitfalls. Figure 2020 on the left shows us overlapping, which makes us think that the branch that is going, that there's a branch going out of the left anterior descending artery. While if you look upper right, you can see that in a different projection, since these are 2D images, that's why we should do different projections. In this one, you can see that it's a trifurcation, meaning that there's, instead of left anterior descendant and left circumflex, there's a third ramus called the ramus intermedius, found in up to 15% of the population. In figure 2021, we can see that there's in the encircled, it looks like there's eccentric coronary lesion in the proximal LAD, which is uncovered by using different projections. That using the second projection, you can see it more thoroughly. Here you can see myocardial bridging. So there's an illustration of a bridge. On top of the bridge, there's a young lad. There's a young lad, and on the other side of a bridge, there's a lady that is yelling to this young lad, "Le voy a dar bebé," which is, or in other words, saying, "I'm gonna give you a baby. I'm gonna give you a baby." Baby has two B's for beta blocker. So, what is the association? The young lad on top of the bridge, this is myocardial bridging. Young lad, left anterior descendant is the one mostly implicated. And the woman that is yelling, baby, is talking about the treatment, an important treatment option, which is beta blocker. It occurs in, in approximately 5 to 10% of patients, and usually involves the LAD. 5 to 10% of those undergoing angiography. And what is characteristic is what is seen in figure 20.22, that in diastole there is a reversible stenosis. That's why it is myocardial bridging. Now about coronary artery spasm. If it is prolonged, it might lead to Prince Metals angina, which may even lead to a end STEMI or even STEMI. What are risk factors for spasm? Alcohol, tobacco use, cocaine, adrenaline, and radiation. What provokes this vasospasm in the cath lab in order to diagnose it? Acetylcholine, ergonovin, or hyperventilation. Okay, so those are the medications. In the presence of endothelial dysfunction, cells cannot produce nitric oxide in response to acetylcholine, resulting in local vasoconstriction. So in this figure, you can see vasospasm. Here, this figure is pretty important because it's about the evaluation of coronary artery stenosis. So you have to evaluate different characteristics or variables. One, in yellow, severity of stenosis, morphologic characteristics, extension and localization of coronary disease in blue. Down below, overall patient assessment. Upper right, peripheral blood flow evaluation. Red, evaluation of collaterals, and green, changes compared to previous angiograms. So, specifically, severity of stenosis. Minimal stenosis is less than 50%. Moderate is 50 to 70%. And severe is more than 70%. Also, we have to take into account that when we are not talking about left main. Left main, more than 50% is to pay closer attention. Okay, then stenosis percentage goes from 0 to 90% as we just mentioned. Lesions over 90% can be divided into 95% if there's contrast media visible in the lesion, and 99% if there's no contrast in the lesion but you can see it after the lesion, and 100% stenosis for total occlusions with no anterograde fill-in. So you can also check this out with visual assessment. It could be qualitative or quantitative, and with quantitative assessment there's less variability. You could use two different techniques: edge recognition or densitometric technique. The inter-observer variability using visual assessment could be up to 20%. Now, what about morphologic characteristics? There's an AHA classification that we'll see next. Also, extension and localization. You have to know the number of vessels diseased, if there's left main involvement, number of lesions in the same vessel, and distance between the lesions. If it's less than 2 centimeters or more than 2 centimeters, the lesion length, the osteal involvement, which osteal would be less than 3 millimeters from the ostium. If there's bifurcation or trifurcation lesions, Medina classification, and overall patient assessment, syntax score, GRC, and different classifications mentioned. Peripheral blood flow, the TIMI, and myocardial blush, we'll talk about that. Evaluation of collaterals, we'll also talk about it. Changes compared to previous angiograms, the degree of the disease, type of stents implanted during the previous one, and prior stent sizes. There are some difficulties with this evaluation, which would be the underestimation of the lesion because of proximal stenosis or atherosclerosis. Other is that there's physiologic narrowing downstream in general in the coronary arteries, so we have to take this into account, and it's hard to interpret this since the narrowing is a constant variable to take into account. So table 20.9 shows us the American Heart or ACC lesion classification, type A, B, and C, and also mention the success rate and complications for each. Then, type A lesion is, if you had to choose, you would like to intervene type A lesions because type C are the most complicated. Then type A is simple, type B is intermediate, and type C are complex lesions. Keywords for type A or simple lesions: lesion length less than 10 millimeters, less than 45 degree angle, discrete lesions, smooth, concentric, low calcium burden, not total or osteal, not totally occluded, not all osteal involvement, no side branch involved in general. And type C would be a length more than 20 millimeters, diffuse lesion, tortuous, and a complete chronic occlusion, which would be more equal to 3 months by definition. Total occlusion, more than 3 months old. degenerated vein graft with friable lesions. And that's it for this one.